Opinions expressed on this radio program do not necessarily reflect the views of this radio station.
My friends and I always tune into the Todd Levitt Law Show. Todd is entertaining, informative, and always delivers the goods.
Todd might not tell you what you want to hear, but he's going to tell you what you need to hear. And all you got to do is listen.
Hold on, Todd. Don't let go. It's time for the Todd L. Levitt Law Show.
Welcome to the Todd L. Levitt Law Show. Good morning, good evening, and good night. I'm yours truly, attorney Todd L. Levitt, broadcasting and podcasting in the Black Diamond Group mothership in the middle of the Mitten, literally, folks, the middle of the Mitten, the lower peninsula located below the Mackinac Bridge or Mackinac Bridge, depending upon where you live and how you say it, with my good friend. You know him, you love him. I'm going to take up the entire segment introducing him. Craig Russell, the muscle, don't call me Mando, America's favorite nug, the gas man, dank, 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 Craig Russell, the water's wet, the sky is blue, you are the strain of the week, and we love smoking you. Happy Memorial Day weekend, Craig Russell.
Do you realize that intro was almost a minute and a half long?
That was one breath, by the way.
It gets longer and longer every
time.
That
was one deep breath.
You know what? It really doesn't matter where people live. They should definitely pronounce it the Mackinac Bridge, because that's how you pronounce it.
It's definitely the Mackinac Bridge.
Not Mackinac.
Not Mackinac. It's the Mackinac Bridge connecting the two peninsulas.
Yes. The upper and the lower peninsula. Todd, I am fan-flippantastic. How are you? Happy Memorial Day weekend.
Craig Russell, the muscle, I could not be better because I'm in studio with one of my best friends on planet Earth, third rock from the sun, enjoying and just destroying it this morning, this afternoon or evening, whenever the heck you're listening to the show or podcast. By the way, big shout out to all the podcast downloaders, Craig, all over the country.
Yeah.
Cali coming in second after Michigan last week.
That's crazy. Just some of the numbers we see. Unbelievable, the amount of people who actually listen to this heap of a show and like what we do. I don't know why, but they do.
Yeah, we haven't heard from Sparky in a minute, but we love Sparky.
Yes.
But Illinois came in second, New York, Texas, Florida, and then across the ocean, Germany, Spain, England, New Zealand, Australia this week, rounded out Brazil, the top downloads in the world on planet Earth.
Wow.
But Craig, early you asked me how I was freaking doing. Firehouse, Shake and Tumble, how could I be doing? We just decided to destroy it. For those who decide to get up early this morning or whenever you listen to the show, was some Firehouse today. I love that. That song just gets me going.
You know, whenever people ask me about the show, that is the one thing that they bring up, the music on the show, because we went from last week doing Gary Puckett in the Union Gap to this week doing Firehouse, and that was the song you wanted to open the show with, and we opened the show with. But what was the song you really wanted to open the show with?
Well, to all my friends, family, fraternity brothers, and people who know me for decades, big shout out to Nevy, Matt Nevison up there, Ray, Ray Hella, all my friends from Berkeley living to the north now. Berkeley Bears, go Bears,
Townie.
Class 83. Townie. Well, Townie's my fraternity brother in Traverse City, yeah.
Yep.
O'Boyle, love O'Boyle. Up all night. For those of us that used to stay up all night back in the day having a good time, turning it and burning it, let's play one for those guys, Craig.
Band's name is Slaughter, and you know where they get the name from?
I do. One of the members' family owned a butcher, so they named it Slaughter.
No.
I would be wrong, wouldn't I?
You would be 100% wrong.
I figured
The
much.
Lead singer is named Mark Slaughter. Much like Eddie Van Halen, much like Kip Winger, Slaughter just is a great name for a band, and he just happened to have a great name, and there you go. I actually have a Slaughter story. Would you like to hear my Slaughter story?
I don't have a choice, but yeah, go ahead. I would love to hear your story because I love your stories, Craig.
So early on in my radio career, I worked at a small station in Battle Creek, Michigan, the Serial City. And Slaughter did a show in Kalamazoo, and their tour bus came through and actually parked in our radio station parking lot for about 2 hours after the show they did. And we went on the air and said, "Hey, come down and see Slaughter. They're here." And literally there were 400 girls trying to get onto this bus. And I think quite a few of them made it on. And you know what happens on tour buses. Lots of sleeping happens on tour buses. Let me just say that.
Yeah, right.
But those guys knew how to party. Let's just say this was like 30 years ago. I'm sure they aren't doing that anymore. But, you know, back in the day when they were 20 years old and had hair down to their butts and they were, you know, playing rock and roll music and going to places like Battle Creek. They were enjoying themselves. So Slaughter, yeah, they brought the tour bus to B95 in Battle Creek, and that was quite the fun time.
Sounds like it. Craig, we have a huge announcement.
We do have a huge announcement.
Yeah,
it's
unbelievably huge. This huge announcement came to our noggins after last week's show. And, look, I just want to say this. There's a lot of sadness going on out there. We're not going to talk about it, but our thoughts and prayers obviously go out to everyone out there. We don't need to bring it up. It's been, it's sad. A lot of sadness. We're parents, and thoughts and prayers, and we're just going to leave it at that for now. But, we try to come on the show and, provide some information and make
some
people smile a little bit. But
yeah.
It's hard to do sometimes with so much grief and sadness. But, we're going to keep the show going with those thoughts in mind. That's all I want to say.
That's our big announcement?
No, that's not our announcement.
Oh, okay. I was going to say.
No.
That was not the big announcement
we talked
about before the
show. I just wanted to say that because we sit here and have the benefit of exercising, our constitutional rights to, communication and whatnot, but there's just a lot of sadness that goes on. We're not getting into any of the politics or any of the of what happened. Everybody knows what's been happening. But, I just want to say that we're not – we understand how, what's going on out there, but we're just trying to do our show and just keep moving forward here, keeping all those people in our thoughts and the kids and the families and everyone.
So what's the big announcement?
So the big announcement is, I think we should have a toga party. Did I not tell the listeners what happened last week?
So you give me a call. I was actually sitting in the Cracker Barrel parking lot getting Cracker Barrel takeout for my kids.
Nice.
You give me a call.
The Cracker Barrel.
I know. Cracker Barrel's delicious. Fantastic. So you give me a call and you say something to the effect of, "Hey, you should see all the people downloading the show and everything." You go, "I think we should have a toga party." And I'm like, "Toga, Toga, Toga. I'm like doing John Belushi, the toga. And so between, I think it took us about 10 minutes to come up with the plan for a toga party in the fall, like at the casino or something like that.
Yeah, I'd like to get some feedback from our listeners. I mean, we'd have to charge admission because we have to pay for the toga party.
Sure.
We would be playing all the Animal House tunage. I used to have toga parties in our fraternity in the rec room back in the 80s. And, I mean, who does not love going to a toga party? We could have, you know, the best of toga contest with judges and everything. And I can just see all the women showing up in their different toga outfits. And the guys. But we'll definitely play some toga music, some Bob Seger. You make me want to shout, raise your hand down and shout. You know, that song that was in Animal House.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, we could charge admission after we cover costs, give the money away to some charities.
Exactly.
I mean, I'm serious. I want to have a toga party, and I want Little John said he'd come to the toga party. I don't know.
Oh, no.
He'd
Little
have to
John
get,
in a toga.
Do they make toga small enough for Little John?
That would be worth, hold on. Hey!
there you go. That would
be worth the price of admission right there to see Little John in a toga. I'm just going to say it.
Let's call Little John.
Call up Little John and see what he has to say. Toga, toga. Now, wait a minute.
Boy, the production value is outstanding.
It just gets better and better.
Hey, big shout out to everyone in Gladwin, Kevin, and everyone listening to the show this morning.
Okay, yeah, we'll talk about them in a second here.
We got
Little John.
Great
Little John's got to answer.
Gladwin. Come on, Little John.
Little John's got to answer.
Never lets us down.
Come on. I can't believe Little John is not answering the phone. He's got to have a really good reason. You know Little John.
Yeah, we love Little John.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
All
so.
The best, Little John, his family, Zach, everybody. What a great guy.
We love Little John.
Yeah, so. But the toga party, we are a law show, but, you know, it is Memorial Weekend.
Is that legal for us to have a toga party, Mr. Lawyer? Would that be legal?
Yeah, not. Absolutely.
I just want to make sure.
I mean, obviously, you know, you have to be 21 and older. Well, there's going to be alcohol being served there. So 21 and older. I've got to talk to the casino. I think we should have about 300-400 people there. And you have to have a toga. This is the rules. I'm already, because this is how we had to do it in the 80s, folks. You have to have a toga. You have to, you know, have a designated driver or stay at the casino or take an Uber or taxi. We don't want anybody coming to our toga party and leaving.
No.
Anything bad happening
to
them.
Not at all.
But the toga party is going to play music nonstop. I'm talking nonstop. You know what? We should get Jedi Mind Trip as one of the guest performers.
Yeah.
And play.
They're a good band.
Oh, I'll talk. I love those guys. I know all
good
those
band.
Guys.
Yep.
So.
Yeah.
But I'm not even joking. Craig, are you coming to the toga party? Because it's our party.
You know, here's my question.
You have
to
come to the toga party or else I'm not doing it.
I'll come to the toga party. Do you want to see me in a toga, though?
I mean, not necessarily.
Are you going to be in a toga?
Well, of course.
Okay.
Can you see all the guys listening to the show coming in camo togas?
I really hope there's about 7 guys and about 400 girls coming to this party, to be really honest.
I mean, I personally can't say that on the air, but, you know.
Yeah, I understand.
No, I think it'll be an equal amount of men and women because.
It probably would be.
When I came up with the idea, I thought to myself, you know what I haven't done in decades? Go to a toga party.
Are you ready?
Toga. Toga.
Toga.
Toga.
Toga.
Toga. And if those listening out there have no idea what we're talking about, I mean.
Watch
really?
Animal House this
Come
weekend.
Come on.
Watch Animal House over the weekend. Sometime over this holiday weekend, watch Animal House and think about a toga.
My entire SIGET fraternity will be present.
There you go.
My decade and beyond.
A legitimate band from campus fraternity on at the toga party, that gives it all kinds of credibility.
Right.
Now,
SIGEPs were banned for life.
I know.
Michigan.
But
that's
they weren't banned
story.
From the casino. Weren't banned from this toga party.
No. The SIGEPs are invited to the toga party.
Gotta
we'll invite all the other fraternities that, you know, from Central, all the different colleges.
Oh, my
but,
God.
But all the people listening to the show, tickets will be limited ticket sales. We'll do it online, and it'll be a lot of fun.
Toga. 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 Hey, we should take a break on the Todd I Love a Law Show. When we come back, we've got law, and we've got to talk about these guys in Gladwin listening. We'll talk about that.
Yeah, I got to talk about your cat comment last week. It went over my head until I re-listened to the show, and I didn't catch it. I didn't catch the cat comment, no pun intended. Craig Russell.
We'll be right back.
You want to dance?
Huh?
Do you want to dance?
Yeah.
You know you make me wanna kick my
Welcome back to the Craig Russell, the Muscle, the Hustle, Don't Call Me Mando, and the Todd 11 Toga Party Memorial Day weekend, everybody.
Woo!
That was a Toga Party 2022
Otis Day in the Nights. That's we kind of tossed it up a little bit there. Otis Day in the Nights. You know, my man Otis.
Oh yeah.
What a great movie.
So what were we talking about, Craig, for those just tuning in for the first and last time?
We're talking about possibly
for the first
we were talking
and
about
last,
throwing
we've lost
a toga.
The audience.
Hey, when are we having this toga party? When do we decide we're going to have it sometime
in the
fall?
Yeah, sometime in the winter time at the casino.
Okay.
I haven't even talked to the casino yet to get their approval, but I don't see why not. What a great event. And I bet, you know, maybe it's going to I'm not even joking about having this toga party.
I got to be really honest with you. A central football weekend, like a Saturday at the casino with the toga party and then having kids from the school come over, I think it's got a lot of possibilities. Just saying.
Absolutely. And it would be for a good cause. We'll give, you know, the funds to those groups out there. We know who they are.
We should find another fraternity that's getting ready to get kicked off of campus and give them the money, much like the Sig Eps.
No, the Sig Eps deserve it. I was part of that, okay?
I know you were. You don't think there's another fraternity that's getting ready to get kicked off of campus?
I'm not sure about
double
that.
Double secret probation?
There's always some fraternity somewhere getting kicked off campus.
Yeah, double secret probation to the Delta House. Come on, you know? It just lends itself to all of this.
Nice.
Oh, my God. That's great. That's great. So what were we talking about? So you enlightened me to a group of people from Gladwin who listen to the show every single week.
Yeah, Kevin.
Okay.
I'll just say Kevin, because there's a lot of Kevins out there.
All right.
But, yeah, absolutely. Kevin, group of people from Gladwin, Michigan, get together and listen to the show. We definitely appreciate those guys.
Yeah.
And they're going to have a special table well, there won't be any tables at the toga party, because too many people will be jumping up and down, but they're definitely invited to the toga party.
You think they'll show up to the toga party?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay. Right on. You bringing Jen to the toga party?
You know it. You show it in a toga. Craig,
Rachel coming to the toga party?
Abso-freaking-lutely. Everybody's invited.
What about Gab? Your whole office? You're Gavin and everybody?
Everybody's invited.
Everybody's invited to the toga party. I gotcha. All right. Well, hey, thanks to Kevin and everyone in Gladwin who checks out the show every week. So what is this about me? What did I say about a cat last week that you missed?
I don't know.
What?
You had some figure of speech about a cat. Don't throw the cat or grab the cat by the tail. Not sure what it was.
Okay. Yeah, I don't even remember. I don't even remember.
How about
my mind is covered with toga party right now. I've got a sheet over my head. I'm already thinking about it. So
how
John
about
Belushi
a United
now.
States Supreme Court case? A little bit of law on a law show today.
Okay, what's going on with that? What happened?
Minnesota versus Olson.
All right.
495 U.S. 91, 1990. The United States Supreme Court held, folks, that an overnight guest has a legitimate, Craig, expectation of privacy, and as a result has standing to contest the search of the residence the person is visiting. So this question came up this week at Levitt Law Firm. I'll just leave it at that. In the context of the search of a residence and the individuals who were inside this dwelling. And the question is, what expectation of privacy does an individual have if they do not live in the residence or the house or apartment, which is a residence,
okay,
that is being searched?
All right.
Either with a warrant or one of the exceptions to a warrant. And so that is something we had to research. And in Minnesota versus Olson, our great United States Supreme Court held that, yes, an overnight guest does have a legitimate expectation of privacy, as opposed to somebody who is merely a guest for a few hours, just visiting somebody. So, and the expectation of privacy comes into play, Craig, and listeners, when the house is searched and certain items are seized and there's going to be challenges in court by the attorneys. So that's why the question of standing, what is standing? That's with any search and seizure issue, and as I mentioned, warrantless or otherwise, the first question a lawyer will ask a client is, you know, does that client have standing to contest the search of the home in which the evidence was found. So this involved a drug case where there was evidence found as a result of a search by law enforcement. And this individual was an overnight guest. And so therefore, they did have standing to contest the evidence as a result of being charged.
So, now, does it make any difference? Let's say I'm an overnight guest at your house. I stay overnight at your house. That I'm an overnight guest. Would it matter if, let's say, I rented an Airbnb and the original owners weren't home, but I was staying there? Would that change anything?
No, you would be considered an overnight guest. And in the context of residential, you know, searches, based on my research and Rachel Levitt, attorney at law, case law breaks it down into two categories: those who actually live in the house and those who are merely visiting. So, you know, it's, you have to define whether it's a resident, whether they are owners, renters, or otherwise, you know, lawfully residing at the house, or it could be a motel room, an Airbnb. Those individuals will always have standing. And there was a Michigan case, People versus Wagner. It was a 1981 case in which the defendant lived in a townhouse that his girlfriend had rented. And he had standing to raise the issue of, you know, proprietary search and seizure in the townhouse. He wasn't on a lease, but he was, you know, he was living with her, even though it was in her name. So,
see, I would think it would be different in a motel or a hotel, because those are designed specifically for people to just stay short amounts of time. Airbnb, that's somebody's house.
Yeah, but you still have, the United States Supreme Court defines it as, did the overnight guest, and here's the key right here, folks. Did the overnight guest, Craig, have a legitimate expectation of privacy and thus has, you know, standing to contest the search of the residence that the person was visiting or staying in? Was the person a mere visitor or just a social guest? Because a mere visitor or social guest has been found not to have standing. And again, this comes in the context of a house that was searched, it was raided, you were there, evidence was seized, you get caught up in it. Do you have standing? And that's important. I mean, there's all kinds of reasons why there are warrantless searches to a dwelling. You know, there's exigent circumstances is one recognized exception to the Fourth Amendment warrant requirement. There's something called an emergency aid doctrine, Craig. Emergency aid doctrine, I should say. It's kind of early in the morning.
Yeah.
Memorial Day weekend. But the emergency aid doctrine, you can figure out how that's defined, right?
Right. Yeah. I mean, here's a question. Who was actually searched? Was it the people who were the overnight guests or the people who lived in the house already?
Well, there was evidence that was found, not necessarily on the individual, but within the vicinity of the dwelling that the individual was as an overnight guest. So they therefore got charged with, visiting a drug house, some possessory charges as well. Everybody got thrown into it. And so the question became, did this individual who was just an overnight guest have standing, you know, to contest, you know, what was seized and some of these issues? Or were they merely visiting and were they, you know, were they, but this, the Supreme Court has ruled that somebody staying overnight does have that legitimate expectation of privacy.
We'll see that because it's like.
But the question becomes, did the officers have a right in the first place to enter the dwelling?
Yeah.
Under these circumstances without, yeah. You know, did they have an arrest warrant? Does the arrest warrant, you know, give them the ability to search the dwelling? The answer is yes. Was there consent? You know, often, so here's another issue that comes up under the Fourth Amendment. Often an officer will knock on the door and a guest who is staying the night will open the door, inviting the officers into the house.
Okay.
So the question is, does that guest opening the door, inviting the officer in, is that consent? And courts have ruled, yes, it is. Because other arguments have been made to say, hey, wait a minute. This person wasn't on the lease. They weren't a renter. That's not their mortgage. How do they have standing to waive my constitutional right against illegal search and seizure or any, not that it's illegal, but any type of, you know, entry by law enforcement without a warrant? You see, an officer comes to the door, knocks on the door, doesn't enter the dwelling, doesn't even cross the plane as it's defined into the dwelling. So a guest opens the door, a guest who is staying overnight as it's determined and defined. you know, and the courts have ruled that, yes, that guest can consent and waive the owner's constitutional rights against entry by the officer. And, you know, you could read case law and see both arguments for and against this, Craig.
Yeah, because that doesn't make a lot of sense, but...
Well, yeah, I think it does. I mean, if you have an expectation of privacy and have standing to contest evidence that was seized as a result of a search by law enforcement, then the courts obviously are going to rule if you are that same guest and you go to the front door, or the back door, or the side door, and an officer is knocking and you invite that individual in. Well, you can't argue on the one hand, you have expectation of privacy. And then on the other hand, you know, the homeowner can't then argue, well, that same person did not have the ability to allow that officer into my dwelling. You know, he can't consent to invite that officer in, but the courts have ruled otherwise.
Hmm. Wow. Because I would think if you don't live there, you're just a guest, you lose some of those kind of rights. That's giving some broad power to somebody who just happens to be an overnight guest.
Well, again, you know, look at both circumstances. There's also the plain view doctrine.
Okay. Sure.
Under the plain view doctrine, an officer is permitted, and this is law school 101, to seize items without a warrant when those items are in plain view and the officer is lawfully present in a location where the items are seized. There's actually
that part
a Michigan
makes sense.
Case,
you
People
you
versus
open the
Fletcher.
Door.
It's a 2004 case.
Yeah, you open the door, even if you don't let the police officer in, and he looks in and sees you, you know, doing a line of cocaine off the table, there's your plain view right there. I mean, I totally get that part. But it seems weird that somebody who does not have, who shouldn't have standing in the house letting an officer in is able to do that.
Right, but, you know, but folks, for those of us who are constitutionalists, like you and I, we love the Constitution. You know, it's a basic principle of the Fourth Amendment that searches and seizures inside a house without a warrant are presumptively unreasonable.
Right.
So again, I'll say it again. It's a basic principle. I've known this since law school. The Fourth Amendment law that searches and seizures inside a house without a warrant are presumptively unreasonable. And most of the searches that people encounter will just be that, Craig. They're warrantless because there's all these exceptions to a warrant. You know, there's consent, hot pursuit, plain view doctrine. There's an emergency aid doctrine if somebody needs aid. There's the exigent circumstance doctrine, because warrants are generally required to search a person's home or his person unless the, you know, exigent circumstances make the need of law enforcement so compelling that, you know, warrantless searches reasonable under the Fourth Amendment. And that's also a United States Supreme Court case.
So let me ask you this. So let's say I'm at your house and I open the door and I invite an officer in. He doesn't have a warrant. He searches, finds a bunch of stuff. There's a good chance that's going to get thrown out because he doesn't have a warrant, correct?
Well, no. If you invite the officer in and look, if you're a guest, the question is, if you're a guest, you just happen to be visiting, you just got there, you've only been there 5 minutes, an officer shows up, you invite the officer in, I would argue that you did not have standing to let that officer in.
Agreed.
Now, there are some courts that, you know, will argue otherwise. We just had this discussion. Now, it depends on why the officer is there, and when the officer enters the dwelling and, you know, evidence is found, what was the reason for the officer being there in the first place? Did the officer wander off into areas that had nothing to do with the plain view doctrine? If the officer comes into your living room but then starts to search the upstairs, but there was no reason for the officer to go upstairs in the first place, my interpretation of law is that any evidence found as a result of that will be thrown out of court.
Yeah,
because the officer, he or she exceeded the scope of why they were there in the dwelling in the first place. Let's say they were in the dwelling under the first aid doctrine, because when they got to the dwelling, you know, the door was open. They saw somebody in dire straits that needed serious medical attention, and it's in the public's best interest that they be allowed to enter into the dwelling, into the living room, to assist first aid until the first responders get there. And once the first responders get there, that officer decides to take a little stroll upstairs, finding all kinds of contraband. Well, I would argue constitutionally that all that has to be thrown out.
Yep.
And that was illegal. That is definitely fruits of the poisonous tree right there.
That makes a lot of sense. That does.
Does that make sense?
Oh, it does. It makes total sense.
A lot of this is law school 101. It's just something that's been stuck in my noggin for 30 years. I also, as a practicing attorney, and even though I specialize in license restoration and drunk driving cases, I do keep up on the laws and case law and what's happening both at the federal and state level, not just Michigan, but other states as well. Because often, you know, federal law, which controls everything, sometimes there's conflict between state and federal law, but federal law rules.
Well, I'll say this much. If it's law 101 for you, remember, some of us didn't go to law school. So it's new information for us.
I'm just trying to make this interesting.
Yeah,
you know,
no.
I think it's interesting that, again, you know, did the officer exceed his or her scope of the warrantless search? And therefore, does an individual have standing, if they get caught up in this, to, you know, have their attorney file motions to quash whatever evidence was seized and any statements that were made? I find it extremely interesting. And that's one of the things I love about being a lawyer.
Speaking of that, we've got to take a break on the Todd L. Levin
Toga,
show.
Toga, Toga, Toga.
But when we come back, we're going to talk a little bit about Memorial Day. That's next. Back to the Todd L. Levitt Law Show. Back, coming back strong with a little bit of Firehouse. I met those guys, too. We used to have pool parties at the radio station. I worked out in Kalamazoo, and we had pool parties. We had Firehouse. Those guys came by and did acoustic versions of Love of a Lifetime. Nice guys. Really good guys. Todd is here. I am here. It's Memorial Day weekend. Todd, you know the importance of Memorial Day weekend, do you not?
Absolutely.
What is Memorial Day weekend all about?
Well, absolutely. Coming from a family of veterans, most of the United States Army, Fort Benning, Georgia, father-in-law was in Vietnam. He was in the Army. Memorial Day is an American holiday, folks, obviously, and it's observed on the last Monday of May, honoring the great men and women who sacrificed their lives while serving in the U.S. military. So, thank you to all those individuals and their families who have sacrificed so much that, you know, we can be here today exercising our constitutional rights. And those who are currently serving, we love our vets and the sacrifice that they make in their families. We can never thank them enough, ever.
That's true. Memorial Day is about the people who died for our country. Veterans Day are the people who fought and survived. And Armed Forces Day are the people who are currently fighting. This is the day we memorialize the people who gave the ultimate sacrifice for their country to let us do what we do. You know, to have the freedoms that we have the life that we have. We say it all the time that we love our vets and we love our military. And where would we be without them? You know, I mean, just, you know, the sacrifices that these families that people have made, not only fighting, overseas. Obviously, there's never really been a war in our country, at least not for a long time. But fighting overseas, fighting in other countries, fighting in other climates and other areas so we can have the quality of life that we have.
Yeah, and I wish
it was more than a day.
Great point. And also, how about the men and women who serve in the National Guard, the Reserves?
Oh, yeah.
We're in Michigan, we're a military state. We have Graylings, Selfridge Air Force Base growing up. We always used to, drive out there and watch the planes. But there's so many men and women who, are active and give to the reserves after they leave active duty or just go into the reserves, the National Guard, the Coasties, the Coast Guard, Air Force, Army, Marines, the Seabees. There's so many different branches of the military, the Special Forces. Yep. And I've known so many men and women who grew up with parents in the military who had to move from state to state, school to school, and sacrificed so much. I mean, so not only are their parents sacrificing their lives, but, you know, the families also are sacrificing so much, moving overseas to Germany. I had friends who went over to Germany. So, yeah, definitely we love our vets.
We do. And also, here's the other part of this. Of course, it's the unofficial kickoff to summer. We want to make sure everyone is safe. You know, you're going to be maybe out on the boat. The weather's supposed to be pretty nice the rest of the weekend. Maybe you're going to be out on some four-wheelers out in the back on the trails. Maybe you're going to be just driving somewhere. There's going to be a lot of, you know, cookouts and alcohol and stuff going on. Please, for the love of God, don't drink and drive. Don't drink in boat. Don't drink in recreational vehicle. Don't drink in ORV. Don't do any of that stuff. You're just asking for trouble. We do this every year around this time. We do a show. We talk about this. Get the message. Don't do it. Give the keys to somebody else. Let somebody else take you where you need to go. If you're going to imbibe, which is perfectly your right, you know, you've got a lot of rights as Americans. You certainly can do that, but please be safe. And we, because even though I, you know, this is how you make your living, Todd, you don't want to get any calls Tuesday morning from people who need your services, even though
and on the way
you
home,
are there. You are
yeah,
there.
And on the way, well put, Craig. Very well said. And on the way home, folks, no matter where you are listening to the show, slow down.
Yeah.
A lot of people have cabins and cottages, and you're visiting Airbnbs. Yep. I cannot tell you how often, you know, leaving God's country up there in the great state of Superior over the Mackinac Bridge in the Upper Peninsula, you know, I'm heading home, and people are just, they're just speeding, going crazy. The more people on the road, the more cautious you need to be. Mm-hmm. You should be cautious all the time. But if don't wait till the last minute to get home, and then you have to rush and put everybody's lives at risk.
Yep.
Leave early, take your time, or leave the next day.
Yeah, and pay attention. Don't text and drive as well. Don't think you're invincible, because guess what? You're not. I'm telling you. Make sure you pay attention to what you're doing. Take it slow and steady. Slow and steady wins the race. Remember that? Remember the turtle? Slow and steady wins the race?
Turtle wins the race. The rabbit took off running, but
right.
The turtle won the race. Craig, you are not only Mando, but you are the turtle, and you won the race in my eyes. And you're going to be the MC at the Toga party. I can't wait.
Toga, Toga, Toga. I'm a zit. Get it?
That's great.
From animals.
But no, so look. We were talking about, you know, standing and search and Fourth Amendment and whatnot. The important thing is if you are involved in a situation where you are staying overnight and you know, something happened while you were residing there, make sure you hire an attorney who understands the Constitution, the Fourth Amendment, all the exceptions to these warrantless searches and how to apply them. And how to apply standing in your case. Was there consent? Was there a search warrant, you know, incident? Was there an arrest warrant, search warrant? There are arrest warrants and search warrants. So basically police who have an arrest warrant for police who have an arrest warrant for an individual may enter that person's home to make the arrest without the need for a separate search warrant, Craig. So that's something important to know.
Gotcha.
Yeah, absolutely. So people don't understand the difference. Well, how can they enter my home? They didn't have a search warrant. They only had an arrest warrant. Well, that's another United States Supreme Court case from 1980.
Yeah.
That's Peyton versus New York. So, but this was where this Peyton case, it was expressly limited to, this was a felony arrest warrant. But there are courts that give equal force to misdemeanor arrest as well. Again, there's federal law and there's state law, and often some of these laws come into conflict, but you need to see what the United States Supreme Court has ruled. That's the law of the land right there.
And I will say this much. I know you said, you know, make sure you hire a lawyer that knows about standing and stuff like that. Even though you're talking about all this, If people call your office at 989-772-6000, you know, you're going to say to them, hey, that's great and everything, but I've got a better lawyer who knows more about this than I do, and you're going to help them find the right lawyer for their case because you do drunk driving restoration and license restoration, but, you know, this law is not your specialty, but you've got a whole cabin, a whole bullpen of lawyers that you can call upon.
Oh, absolutely.
This is their expertise, and they'll be able to help you out without a problem.
The one thing we don't have time to talk about is the good faith exception, Craig, so people need to look that up. The good faith exception, even if a warrant is defective. So look that one up. So the bottom line is our constitutional rights when it comes to privacy in a motor vehicle have been completely destroyed. In the home, they're still strong, but most searches are done in hot pursuit or in plain view or one of these exceptions to the warrant requirement. And again, it's not my specialty. I just find it interesting. And I thought on Memorial Day weekend, as we support our vets and those who have sacrificed, that we talked about something other than what we talk about each and every week, with sometimes it's just absolutely nothing.
That's correct.
I mean, truly.
Nice way actually talking about between, you know, the TOGA party and law, we're talking about some stuff that counts.
Yeah.
Talking about some stuff.
Because we are a law show and I've been practicing law for a long time.
Yeah.
But now, if you call my office, there's a good chance you'll talk to the other attorney on staff, Rachel Levitt, who is just a brilliant attorney with a mind of a Supreme Court judge. She understands how to interpret case law and apply it. And that's a unique talent. Not all lawyers have that ability to understand, you know, the legalese and how the case laws and decisions and opinions affect everyday lives and how to utilize those in court. Rachel's one of those lawyers, folks, and I'm just fortunate as her father to have her part of Levitt Law Firm now to bring that extra 1-2 punch to representing our clients.
And you can tell you're just proud as punch because you can tell you can hear the pride in your voice when you're talking about what kind of a great lawyer she is. And how she helps Levitt Law. So that's what that's what we like. Hey, we got to take a break on the Todd L. Levitt Law Show. When we come back, we'll go TOGA a few more times and we'll wrap the show up.
Welcome back to the Todd L. Levitt Law Show. Happy Memorial Day weekend, and thank you to all the vets who have sacrificed and their families, Craig.
And it would not be a Memorial Day weekend without a strain of the week. Do we have Judd on the line?
We've tried to contact Judd during break. Let's try one more time here,
please,
Craig.
Leave your message for...
What? Come on, Judd.
Come on, Judd. First, we can't get a hold of Lil John. Now we can't get a hold of Lil Judd.
Let's try that one more time.
All right.
Please leave your message.
Oh, come on.
Well, what was the strain the strain was going to be this week? Do we know what it was?
I have no idea. This is all ad-libbed. I just have no idea.
Judd. Come on.
Come on, Judd.
Come on. First Lil John, then Judd. Next thing you're going to tell me, you're going to try and call Big Hair, and he's not going to be there either.
Now, we're going to call G-Money.
G-Money.
We're going to call G-Money.
Get some G-Money on the air.
G-Money. First time on the show, G-Money.
Boy, the production value of the show just gets better and better.
Grant, hey, G-Money, a.k.a. Grant.
Hey.
Hey, welcome to the show of all shows, Craig Russell, the muscle, the hustle. Hey, say hello to Grant.
What's going on, Grant?
Hey, Grant.
Hey.
Hey, how about I couldn't get a hold of Judd for the strain of the week, the show for Memorial Day weekend. What you got for us, Grant? You got a strain of the week?
Jeez. On the spot, I guess I would have to say Fat Kid's Cake.
Fat Kid's Cake, one of the all-time favorites of the show. Yes, yes. Fat Kid's Cake. And who are the parents of Fat Kid's Cake there, G?
It's a very creamy strain, indica-like, some sativa. It's a 60-40 hybrid, so it tastes really good, has good effects. Mellow if you need it to be mellow, and uplifting if you need it to be uplifting.
Nice. Okay. Well,
all right.
G Money Grant, thank you for being put on the spot. We couldn't get a hold of Little John. We couldn't get a hold of Judd. And we've talked about
having to be do my part occasionally, you know. Yeah, I'm here for you, whatever you need.
Yeah, I mean, the strain that Judd was going to present on the show was inappropriate for the show, so we nixed it. But
gotcha.
Yeah, but Grant, say hi to everybody there. Yes. And
we'll do.
Have a good Memorial Day weekend. Be safe. Congratulations. And we welcome you back on the show in the future. I know we put you completely on the spot there, but you did great.
Yeah, I appreciate it. Yep. Thank you. All right. Yep. Can't wait to be back on.
Well, that was pretty good.
That was G Money right there, Grant.
G Money.
You think he'd come to our toga party?
Oh, he'll definitely be at the toga party.
Todd, I hate to break the news to you, but the show's over. We got to go.
Come on, Craig.
Come on.
Todd. Come on,
man.
Craig, listen, I always enjoy, I hope the listeners enjoy listening to you and I, which I believe they do, as much as I enjoy, you know, talking with you once a week and having the opportunity to do so. And I give thanks to our veterans here on Memorial Day for the sacrifices they have made and their families, the ultimate sacrifice that allow us to keep, you know, exercising our freedom of speech on the radio here. And thanks to Norm and Mike and everyone from the Black Diamond Group as well.
Yeah, but that's right. Tammy and Steve and
Tammy, Corinne, Steve, everybody, absolutely.
And everybody and Carmi and everybody. Yes, we appreciate it very, very, very much. Todd, we got to go. Show's over.
Craig, two words. Toga. We're not here for a long time. We're here for a good time. And if you're not moving forward, you're getting left behind. Take us out with a little T-O-G-A. You know you make me wanna kick my heels up and down. Throw my hands up and down. Throw my hands back and down. Come on now, don't forget to say you will. Don't forget to say yeah. Say you will. Say it right now, baby. Say you will. Come on. Say you will. Say that you will. Say you will. Say that you love me. Say that you need me. Say that you want me. Say you wanna please me. Say come on now. Say come on now. Say come on now. Say I want you to know.
Make me wanna lift my head up and throw my head back and come on now, come on now, come on now. A little bit softer now, 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 a little bit softer.
Todd L. Levitt Law Show, brought to you by Chad Malley Well Drilling of Rosebush, Clark Modular Homes of Mount Pleasant, Ace of Diamonds of Mount Pleasant, Clear Vision Windows, Siding, and Roofing, now booking in Central and Northern Michigan, and attorney Todd L. Levitt.
Opinions expressed on this radio program do not necessarily reflect the views of this radio station.